Good evening, Mr. Ranjit. Can you hear me, sir?
I can hear you. Good evening.
Sir, it's definitely a great privilege and honor for me to have this live conversation with you.
Thank you.
So if you're finishing any work, we'll wait for you, no problem.
I'm done. I was just trying to see if I can get the video better.
So, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's definitely a big pleasure and honor for me to have a live conversation with Mr. Ranjit Gupta, CEO of Azure Power. Mr. Ranjit is an extremely well-known figure and a personality, not only in the renewable energy sector, but in the entire power sector. A very, very old and a seasoned person who has been serving the power sector since an extremely long time. Sir doesn't need any introduction, but definitely we'll hear from sir about his past life and experience and his past roles. So, good evening, Mr. Ranjit. How are you, sir? I hope everything is good with you.
Everything is good. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Anna.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for joining us. It is extremely, extremely interesting. Sir, I think one of the most important aspects that we see that you have served the power sector in various roles and since an extremely long time. I think it's been probably more than 15 years that you have worked in various companies, various roles. So, and you have education from India's best academic institution. So, sir, at the start of the conversation, we'd love to know more about your previous roles, assignments, companies, your education, and what has been your basic key learnings and the key values that you have acquired that has helped you to come so far in life, so top in life, and you now have a responsibility to head one of the biggest IPPs and the most respectful IPPs around the world, sir. Over to you.
Thanks, Anand. Thanks for the kind words. So yes, I've been lucky to be working in the power sector. Now I've been working for almost 29 years in my career, 17 of which have been with the power sector, and 12 years with the oil and gas sector. The first 12 years of my career were spent with oil and gas, and then now the last 17 have been with the power sector, and I'm perhaps one of the few people who have worked on hydro, on thermal, on biomass, on wind and solar, in all sectors. I've had the opportunity to work. Some have been successful, some have been not so successful, but every experience has given me something, some learnings, and now, the last 10 years. I've been working in the renewable energy sector, which is certainly one of the best sectors currently in the country to be working for. Apart from the fact that this is a sustainable sort of energy source for the grid, and this is also the future for the grid. Before working with Azure, I worked with Austro. Austro Energy was a private equity invested platform, which was founded in 2014, and we built 1,000 megawatts of assets there, largely wind. Before that, I was in another private equity backed platform called Orange Power, that was founded by Murali Subramanian, Gopinath, and myself. We built a few megawatts there, including something on the biomass side. Before that, I used to work as a CEO for Indiabulls Power, which is now currently Ratan India Power. We built thermal assets there, two very large thermal assets, using coal as a main fuel. And before that, I worked a little bit, a few years in hydro sector. So I built a couple of small plants on the hydro side, on the small hydro side. So I've had the opportunity to work in a gamut of technologies across the power sector. So it's been a great journey, and I'm very excited to be part of Azure. As you said, Azure is a very important part of the solar sector in India. It's practically the oldest IPP. Azure was formed in 2008, when practically there was no solar sector in the country. So to that extent, Azure has had a very important role to play in the development of the solar sector. And along with other participants, I believe that Azure is also one of the key movers and shakers in the solar world currently. And I'm proud to be associated with Azure. I've been there for about 13 months now, and it's been a great journey.
Sir, definitely is extremely interesting to know your journey right from oil and gas to India Bulls, where you have been working on thermal power, and then you've also worked with Orange and Ostro, and in hydro also you've done work. So I'm sure the kind of insight you have and understanding about the various power generation sources and their emerging importance, or what I would say that the way the power sector is evolving in terms of the change in the mix of power generation sources. So what has been your learning, sir, in these, and way forward, how the entire scenario will be kind of changed in terms of definitely we see renewables more to come, but what will be the role of other sources, the costs per se, the role in terms of grid management, or how this entire trajectory can be looked upon in for the core power sector?
So I think as a country, we have to look at various things, right? It cannot be just a 0-1 decision, in the sense that I believe that we cannot just look at the fact that, because coal is a source of energy that is perhaps not as clean as renewable, so therefore we can get everything from renewable. There are several challenges in that, right? First of all, of course, the dispatchability of renewables is still suspect. It's very expensive to dispatch renewables. So therefore, at this point in time, coal plays an important role along with other sources like hydro or gas in terms of balancing the grid. Other than that, I believe that even when 2 or 3 or 4 years down, storage will become a very important part of the energy mix. Even at that time, we have to understand that as a country, right, there are what, almost 200, 220,000 megawatts of thermal assets which have been installed. So it cannot be that one fine day we say goodbye to all those assets. It's just not tenable. There is a lot of public money that has been spent on building out those thermal assets, and it is the responsibility of the nation. I mean, we are not a very super rich nation that we can just throw coal out of the window, right? So we have to in the short term, or in the medium term, I would say at least over the next 10, 15 years, we have to assume that there will be a mix of coal with other sources of energy. The government is working hard to sort of cleanse the coal. For example, the FGD, which is a flue gas desulfurizer attachments, or the FGD, has been made mandatory for the thermal sector to clean the emission gases, the gases emitted. So the government is working on trying to make the coal power cleaner. But over as far as even when I guess dispatchable renewable energy becomes a reality, we will have a slow decline in coal, and only when that only when the projects are depreciated would we be in a position as a nation to get rid of them. So there has to be coexistence. And just as in case of any other, I mean, when we are looking at oil and gas also, when we talk about an oil basket, the country doesn't go out and buy oil from one country. India doesn't just go to, say, Saudi and say, okay, we need all of this oil. There is a basket. You buy a little bit from Saudi, you buy a little bit from Abu Dhabi, you'll buy a little bit from other oil producing nations, because you need to have a basket. So similarly, on the power side also, we will need a basket. We have a little bit of nuclear, we have some substantial amount of hydro, we have substantial amount of coal, we'll have renewable energy also. So we do need a basket of energy sources in the foreseeable future. 20 years down, 25 years down, what happens, how technology develops, storage will perhaps become very, very widespread. Perhaps solar projects can be built in much smaller areas than they are being built in today. All of those things will change. But in the foreseeable future, over the next 10 or 20 years, I believe that, we will, renewables will coexist along with the other sources of energy.
Rightly said, sir. So as you rightly said about Azure, definitely Azure makes everyone in the power sector or the renewable energy sector proud. I think one of the first private sector power plants, solar power plants in the country was built by Azure. And I'm sure it has, as you also mentioned, that it was a proud moment for you when you got the opportunity to head the company as a CEO. So when as an outsider, how would you look at Azure when you got the opportunity to come into Azure? What kind of things you saw, what kind of things that you wanted to do and or change? And what is, where is it that Azure was standing, and what is the basically revised or the final vision or mission that you have prepared for yourself and for Azure Power, sir?
So, it is odd that when the Azure opportunity presented itself, Murli is my partner. We worked together now for 12, 13 years. So Murli and I were trying to raise money for the next platform post Austro. And when the Azure opportunity presented itself, it was a little bit of a surprise for us because we are not, we didn't have that much experience on the solar side. In Austro, we had built 90% of our assets were wind. 10% were solar. So we didn't know much about Azure at that point in time, except of course the fact that it has been around for a very long time, and that it is one of the larger companies on the solar side, that it had a fabulous set of shareholders, CDPQ, IFC, GIF, Helion, good set of shareholders and a good reputation in the market. So that's all we knew really. And when we spoke to our friends, everybody was very positive about Azure and Azure story. So that's how it progressed. And joining Azure has been an incredible experience. I mean, we have a fabulous team. The team has been around for 10, 12 years. A lot of the folks in the company have been around in the company for a very long time. They understand the sector very well. We have built 1800 megawatts, so from scratch, including land and everything else. So therefore, the company, the tacit knowledge base within the company is fabulous. So the first year has just flown by. I mean, it has been a great experience. And as far as the mission of Azure is concerned, it is to be the lowest cost power producer, solar power producer. So that's what we are aiming to do. We try and innovate and try and make sure that when we are taking part in auctions, for example, or when we are building our projects, that we are producing power at the lowest cost possible, because that, of course, is important for us to be able to make a profit at the end of the day with the tariffs we bid, because unless we produce power at a low cost, we can't sell it at a low cost. So so it has been a great journey. And being, we are blessed to be part of this great team.
I'm sure, sir. I'm sure. So, what is it that the biggest opportunities that you see for Azure Power probably next 1 to 3 years in India or outside India, if you're eyeing abroad markets also? And what is your plan for Azure in terms of scaling up the renewable energy capacity, or in terms of technology adoption for new technologies coming up? How do you plan to counter and basically encash the upcoming opportunities?
So, one of the good things about, amongst the many the good things about Azure, one is the longevity of the platform, right? In the two platforms we worked in, we had a different vision and mission, right? Whether it is Austro or Orange, the vision was to build a platform and then to find the right home for those assets, right? Whereas Azure has a completely different vision, right? Azure's vision is very long-term, right? I mean, this company is, the founders brought the company to a strong place. I hope that, 8-10 years down the road, we can hand it over to the new management team and Azure will be even stronger. And then Azure will continue its journey as a company, right? Whether it is 20 years from now or 30 years from now, the shareholders believe in the longevity of the business. They believe in renewable energy as a sector. they believe in keeping the investment long term in a company. So to that extent, you know, it is a completely different way of looking at the business, right? We look at the business as a continuing business, which is there for the long term. And return to shareholders is of paramount importance to Azure versus capacity, right? So we are not, you know, in the running to be the largest company, because we don't need to be. We are in the running to be the most profitable. That's what we would like to be, so that we can return money to our shareholders and do the best for our stakeholders. So that's a very different, and we don't have a timeline, right? I mean, normally what happens in the business with when you have a different kind of a vision or mission is that you have a particular timeline in mind. So one of the things that we did when we came on board was to say to the board that, look, we don't want to give a megawatt target for the company, right? Because it doesn't fit with the vision of the company. It doesn't fit with the vision of the shareholders. So we would rather, you know, do what is to be done, and build the business up profitably, instead of making sure that we are always busy, always building projects, always investing money. That is not as important for us as to ensure that each project that we build is profitable and we are able to return money to our shareholders. The second thing with Azure is that the growth trajectory can be decided by the company itself, because with the kind of investors we have, the access to capital is not a constraint, right? Because of the fact that they believe in the business, they are very supportive. Our shareholders are very supportive, and they have given us the free hand to decide how much money we need, how much capital we need, and how do we want to arrange that capital? Do we want to raise it in the market? Do we want to do it internally? How do we want to raise the capital? And the board, and we have an independent board, and it's very, very supportive of the growth trajectory that Azure wants to build for itself. So there is no pressure on us to be a particular megawatt by a particular timeline. So that gives us, in a way, the freedom of action, because when you don't have that constraint that you have to win bids at whatever cost, it makes our life a lot easier. So as far as our expansion is concerned, currently our plate is full. We have a portfolio of almost 7,000 megawatts, 1,800 megawatts operating, 1,200 megawatts, 1,300 megawatts are under construction. And we have a pipeline of another 4,000 megawatts. So our hands are full for the next 4 or 5 years. We do have an aspiration to go abroad at some point in time. But at this point in time, it looks like we have plenty to do in India. And actually, the government has also helped in making the business environment friendly for investors as a whole, right? Which is what we see as so many private equity players, so many strategics, so many financial investors have invested money in the renewable energy sector. It's because they have confidence in the longevity of the sector. And we didn't see that on the thermal side. I mean, if you look at the thermal side, there are hardly any players with foreign money on the thermal side, whereas on the renewable side, you see that 80-90% of the money that is invested in the company, in the country, is from foreign investors. So to that extent, right, it is it's a good place to be in. And for us, whether we are in India or we are outside of India will depend on the government policies and our the bandwidth that we have to expand outside of India, or the opportunities that are available in India.
So definitely, and I wish you all the good luck, and I have full confidence. In fact, everyone has full confidence that Azure will always achieve what you dream and what the team dreams. So moving on, and we love to know from you, we keep on hearing about various challenges. So according to you, if you pinpoint, what are the top 1, 2, 3 or the top 3, 4 challenges that you see for Azure or for this sector? And what is your views on them as to how we're going to really sail through these storms?
So, yes. So, whereas, I have said that the government has made investments into the country much smoother, and, the investors believe in the longevity of the sector. But that doesn't mean that we don't have challenges, and we do have challenges. And the good thing, like I said, is that the government is receptive to the industry. The Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, the Minister of Power, are very receptive to the challenges that we face whenever we go to them and talk to them about these, they listen to us. The biggest challenge that, and this is, I don't think anything can be done about that. The biggest challenge for the renewable energy sector is the fact that power is in the concurrent list, which means that the decision making, at the central level is not fully, it's not absolutely their decision, right? I mean, a lot of the power vests with the states. So that becomes a big challenge because the center wants to, go in a particular direction, which might not be the direction in which the states want to go. So that is a challenge which perhaps is, out of the purview of this conversation. Apart from that, I think if you look at the key requests that the industry has, the key requests are around the sanctity of contract, right? For us, I think, everything else pales into insignificance in front of the sanctity of contract. And the sanctity of contract comes in various ways, right? Whether it is in terms of the power purchase agreements that we have already signed, they need to be honored. We have had situations of states, who have asked for tariff revisions, have asked for contracts to be opened, which is very negative, which gives a very negative view of India to the, to the outside world. There have been cases where, letters of awards have been given and there are delays in signing power purchase agreements. That, that actually is also very damaging because when, as a company, and this is not only us, but any company, when we win a contract, when we are awarded a letter of award, at that point in time, we have to make a capital allocation. In fact, at the time of bidding, we have to make a capital allocation, right? And once a capital allocation is made and it's sanctified, once the LOA is given, it reduces our freedom to take part in other auctions if there is a delay on the power purchase agreement signing. So therefore, that blocks our capital and it delays our ability to, roll out our projects. So that is that is also a contract sanctity thing because as per the bid conditions, typically you have to sign your PPAs within a particular time limit from the LOA. So that's also a contract sanctity issue. Then the payment delays is also a contract sanctity issue. I mean, in the contract, it says that you are going to get paid in X amount of time, right? And you don't get paid in that amount of time in many cases. There is, other things in the contract which are related to the approvals that we are supposed to get from the government, or approvals we are supposed to get from the distribution companies related to power procurement or tariff adoption. So sometimes those also get delayed. So I think it's all in all, it's basically the sanctity of contract that is extremely, extremely important for the sector. Apart from the contract sanctity, it is also then, I would say, the ability of the government to have policies which are long-term policies and when there are no variations in policies, right? When policies are made, they are made by the government with a vision in mind that this is how these policies will aid the sector, right? The government typically will not come out with a policy that, is going to harm the industry. Their objective is to make the industry bigger. However, many times when the policies are made and they are rolled out, for whatever reasons, though the long-term advantages of those policies might be plenty, but in the short term, those policies can end up harming the sector more than, helping the sector. For example, the policy that was, related to the duties that were imposed on solar panels through the safeguard duty route, and now the talk about the BCD route. So there is a vision behind those policies. Perhaps the government wants to encourage Make in India, but unfortunately, the way the policy has been written, it is ending up only hurting the industry and not helping the manufacturers. So, as an industry, we support Make in India. We have no issues with doing Make in India. We don't have any issues with having. I believe that manufacturing is actually a low-hanging fruit as far as the solar sector is concerned because we already have installed capacity of manufacturing in India. We know as a nation how to manufacture solar panels and cells, et cetera. So it is a low hanging fruit. But the way to roll it out without disturbing the contracts that have already been bid out is an important feature, which sometimes they don't keep in view on an overall basis. I think some of the issues which are related to the sanctity of contract will get resolved with the tariff policy and with the Electricity Act. So we have been requesting the government to come out quickly with the the Electricity Act. A lot of comments have been given by the industry, and we are hopeful that the Electricity Act will be amended soon. Once the Electricity Act is amended, I think some of the challenges that we face will be taken care of, and we'll again be a happy lot of investors.
So definitely you pinpointed the right challenges, and I think everyone respects Azure for the fact that you have been supporting manufacturing, and you have been probably one of the very few front runners in the manufacturing linked tenders as well. So first of all, definitely congratulations from my side on that. And we'd love to know more about first issue. Definitely is the current biggest threat to all the existing bid out projects, the grandfathering. Sometimes we hear from MNRE that grandfathering definitely will happen, and sometimes they also say that grandfathering would not happen. That really scares the hell out of me. So that the grandfathering is one issue. Secondly, we love to know more about the manufacturing link tender that Azure has won. What are your plans in terms of those more opportunities or this tender that you have won? And definitely regarding Atmanirbhar Bharat, what is your vision? So first, I'd love to know more about the grandfathering issue, since you are very close to the ministry, and that I think is one of the most important topics to be discussed, sir.
So no, you are right. I mean, grandfathering has a huge impact on the industry as a whole. There is almost 30,000 megawatts or 35,000 megawatts of tenders that have been bid out already. And these are 35,000 megawatts of AC tenders, which will end up being almost 50,000 megawatts of imported modules. So for 35,000 megawatts of AC modules, the amount of safeguard duty or BCD combined at 25% will be between 15 to 20,000 crores locked in because of BCD, because it is change in law for all of us. So yes, we find it difficult to comprehend that the government has not come out with a grandfathering policy that wherever these duties which have been applied are tantamount to change in law, those duties should not be applicable. So we have been requesting that. The good thing is that the ministry has been very supportive. The MNRE secretary, the MNRE officers, and the Minister of Power have been lobbying or have been requesting, have been talking to various other arms of the government, whether it is Ministry of Commerce, Ministry of Finance, Prime Minister's Office. So the ministry is very supportive. They are still trying. But, this is a decision that is not entirely in the hands of our ministry. So I think it is taking time. Some days are good days, I think, when they get positive responses, and some days are not that good when they don't get positive responses. But we are hopeful, cautiously optimistic. It has not happened so far. The chances are low at the moment of it happening, but we know that the ministry is trying its best. As far as manufacturing is concerned, there are various ways in which manufacturing can be given a leg up. Like I mentioned, India knows how to manufacture panels. It's not something new, right? It's not something which is not known to us, and therefore it will be a completely new business where we will have to build skills. We'll have to figure out how much it costs, how to do it, and there will be failures in the beginning. No, it is nothing like that. We've had large companies who have been doing panel manufacturing, cell manufacturing in India. So it is, like I mentioned earlier, a low-hanging fruit as far as I can see. The question is, there are structural differences between India and China. And there are many structural differences, right? I mean, it could be the cost of capital, it could be the cost of debt, it could be the cost of logistics, it could be the cost of raw materials, it could be the cost of power, it could be the cost of land, cost of taking all the approvals. There are a gamut of factors, double duties many times, which our manufacturing industry has to pay, which makes our manufacturing industry uncompetitive or less competitive when it comes to getting the modules imported from China. That is certainly a challenge. And the government needs to find a way, if we are serious about Make in India, how to provide a level playing field for the sector. One way is to solve the structural challenges, you know, which is perhaps a little bit more difficult task. And the other way is to create tariff or non-tariff barriers so that we don't import from outside of the country and we are quote unquote forced to use panels that are made in India. On the tariff or non-tariff barriers, there are various ways of going around that. At the end of the day, all of it has you know, two implications. One is on the tariff to the final consumer. Manufacturing tender that we have won, for example, whichever way you look at it, right, it'll impact the tariff. If I have to pay BCD, that is also a tariff impact at the end of the day. The BCD is not coming out of my profits. It's coming out of the tariff. Similarly, if I do a manufacturing link tender where the tariff was slightly higher than the normal tariff, you know, that goes towards you know, a tariff hike for the consumer. So there is one way is to do it through a tariff method where the extra cost of making modules in India is passed on to the consumer. And the other way, of course, is to, you know, remove the reasons for that difference, which is, you know, make sure that the conditions of manufacturing in China are similar to conditions of manufacturing in India, which means a lot of reforms, right? They'll need reforms on the electricity distribution side, on the labor side, on the logistics side, on the duty side. And, you know, so perhaps easier way is the shorter term way is to do it on, you know, on the basis of a tariff, and perhaps a longer term way is to do it through actually removing the structural differences between the markets that are more competitive than us.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Sorry, I think there's actually heavy rains in our area, so there has been a power cut. So continuing with our conversation, sir, as you have described all these challenges, so do you think India will be able to achieve its target of 100 gigawatts? And also we have to factor in the COVID impact. So where do you think we are heading towards in terms of capacity addition practically possible in next 2 to 3 years, sir?
So I think you know, if you hark back to 2014, when Prime Minister Modi set a target for 175,000 megawatts, and all of us fell off our chairs that this is you know, this is a crazy target and we'll never be able to achieve this, when we were adding 500 to 1,000 megawatts every year, right? That was the kind of numbers that we were adding, and it seemed impossible that at some point in time, we'll be able to add 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 megawatts every year. But, you know, we are sitting in 2020. The target is to be at 175,000 megawatts by 2022. And I think largely, if you break the 175 gigawatts into its various components, we'll probably meet most of our targets except on the rooftop. I mean, 60,000 megawatts was the target for ground mount solar. I think we will probably beat that target. The 60,000 megawatts on the wind side, I think we'll probably meet or beat that target. We will of course fall short, I think, on the rooftop solar target, which was supposed to be, I think, around 40,000 megawatts. I think we'll be fairly short there. I think we perhaps underestimated the you know, the challenges of getting 40,000 megawatts built on rooftops. But other than that, I think we are in line to deliver on the vision of the Prime Minister, which is incredible given, you know, where we were just 4 or 5 years ago.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one of the last questions from my side would be, as huge equity and debt financing requirements for the projects that are going to come up is definitely required. So how do you think that the equity and debt financing will happen for the projects to come? And I would also love to know about various exit options that we have been hearing about, mergers and acquisitions, There has been bond listings. Even Azure, I think, has pioneered foreign capital raise. So we'll have to know more about that as well. And also, we have seen only one good or one or very few good IPOs as a exit, especially in the Indian stock exchange. Probably in foreign markets, we can look and look at. So this entire financing system, where do you think is it headed towards? And how do you think it is going to really shape up the lives of the major IPPs?
So I think it's a very, very important question. You know, I mean, there are three elements really to a project in India, right? One is you have to, you know, get financing. Second is you have to procure equipment. And third is you have to actually build and operate the plant. So we have tackled the first one, which is about procurement and modules and so on and so forth. And then finance is one big you know, mover of tariffs. And every 100 basis points in debt cost can be between 10 to 15 paisa on the tariff. Unfortunately, even though the government has made tremendous effort on the availability of debt and on the on how money is being made available to the banks, unfortunately, the banks have not stepped forward to support the industry. Even today, if you look at it, with the repo rate at a record 4%, right, the typical industry project is getting funded between 9.5% to 10.5%, which is a spread of between 5.5% to 6.5%, which is just a very, very high spread. There is no reason, especially when most of our power purchase agreements in the industry are through central-backed entities like SECI or NTPC or NHPC, or with states like Gujarat, Maharashtra. I mean, there is, I cannot see a reason with 35,000, 38,000 megawatts of projects operating. Where is the risk perception as far as the banks are concerned that we are still struggling with this huge spread, right? So, you know, if we could, you know, if we could get 100 basis points, 200 basis points off where the spread is a good 3.5%, 350 basis points from the repo rate, you know, we would be in a much, much stronger position to be able to reduce the tariffs and thereby make renewable energy even more attractive to the distribution companies. Today, when we go out and we get financing from outside of India, right, we are able to achieve interest rates of less than 9% without any issues. A LIBOR is at a record 25 basis points or 30 basis points. You know, you have a little bit of a premium over that because of your the spread over the LIBOR. And then you add 100% hedging on top of that. And you are easily at well below 9% for your debt. So if we can, you know, and on the other hand, so many of us go abroad to raise finance. Whereas in the Indian market, almost 5 lakh, 6 lakh crores every night is parked in reverse repo. So it's just unimaginable as to why at 3.35%, 335 basis point reverse repo, the banks are willing to park money in the reverse repo every night instead of lending it to long-term projects, which are you know, backed by central government entities. So that is something that needs to change. As an industry, we have spoken to the Honorable Finance Minister, we have spoken to Honorable Power Minister. Our Power Minister was also surprised that the spreads are so high, and he has promised to take this up with the Finance Minister. We have written to the RBI. I don't know whether that was appropriate, but anyway, the industry has done what it you know, what it can. And we are hopeful that this will get fixed and we can borrow at a rate which is what the government wants. I mean, otherwise they would not keep dropping the repo rate, right? The reason why they have dropped the repo rate is to you know, to make it possible for the industry to get funding. On the equity side, you know, there is availability of equity, and I think the equity is sort of elastic to a certain extent, in the sense that when we were doing 5,000 megawatts a year, we used to always feel that, oh, you know, there is not going to be equity when we get to 10,000 megawatts. We are close to 8,000-10,000 megawatts a year, and there is equity which is available. Most auctions are competitive. So I believe that you know, as the number of auctions available goes up, the equity will be made available. And it's a balancing act, right? In the sense that when there is lower availability of equity, the tariffs go up slightly. And that's why you will see the tariffs in SECI auctions go up and down. There is not, it's not as if all the tariffs are going down all the time. The tariffs go up and the tariffs go down. And that is a reflection of not only the risk that is perceived in the sector, but also the availability of equity. When equity flow becomes lower, the tariffs go up. When the equity flow becomes better, the tariffs go down. And therefore, it balances itself out with a direction such that the equity availability keeps on increasing on a year-by-year basis. So I'm not too worried about the availability of equity because, you know, every investor has a risk-return equation in mind, right? If we get 20% return, you can perhaps build 30,000 megawatts a year. If you have 18% return, maybe you can build 20,000 megawatts a year. If you have 15% return, you can build 10,000 megawatts. If the government says that we're going to give you only 12% return, then perhaps you can build only 4,000 or 5,000 megawatts because there'll be only that many investors who will be willing to take a return that low. So it's a balance between what the tariffs are and what the investors believe the tariffs can be. The risk perception of the country also plays very important part in how the investors look at the Indian market for investment. But I think it is available. And as far as the exits are concerned, I mean, I think we have seen across various portfolios that there is liquidity. There is liquidity for assets. You know, every 2 months, every 3 months, you see that we haven't had too many successful IPOs. But if you discount the IPOs itself, there is liquidity in the market for investors who want to invest in assets and then, you know, divest those assets. There is liquidity available. It's not as if it's something where you build something and then you're stuck with it and you can't do anything about it. It is not a situation like that. You hear of assets changing hands ever so often.
Thank you very much, sir. That was quite insightful. Now to ask last couple of questions, with your permission, sir, I'd like to invite Mr. Prateek Sharma, who is heading the North Indian region for SunGrow. Mr. Prateek, over to you to ask the questions as you requested.
Very good afternoon to you, sir. It's an honor to asking your opinion on a few questions which we have in mind. So I would like to ask you first question of mine, that as we know that renewable energy source is not available 24/7. And what is your view on the round-the-clock renewable power with energy storage integration in India? So when do you see this renewable energy plus storage to become the new normal in the Indian power sector?
I think, Pratik, thanks. It's a very important question because the longevity of the renewable energy sector will depend on availability of dispatchable renewable power. Right? Sometimes we look at our capacity, especially solar, and say, oh, you know, we are just 3% or 4% or 5% of the grid. What is the big deal? I mean, you know, the problem is that when you have 40,000 megawatts installed, all that 40,000 megawatts kicks in at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So it's not as if, you know, it's 4% across the day and across the night, and therefore it's just a small portion of the grid. The problem happens because, you know, all of it comes in at a particular time. So that is a challenge that will only grow, and dispatchable renewable power is the way out for it. I think storage at the moment, as far as the battery storage is concerned, I think that is still a little bit further down the road. It is still expensive. It might be 2 years or 3 years before it becomes viable. It could be 4. And also, whenever it does become viable, you know, suppose it becomes viable in 2 years, and suppose people start bidding out, and taking part in auctions for storage projects in 2 years from now, by the time those projects come up, it'll be 4 years from now. And you know, even if you are doing a couple of thousand or 4,000 or 5,000 megawatts of storage projects a year, it'll take a very, very long time for us to actually get to a place where, you know, these storage projects are going to make a meaningful impact. But you see, the government has just come out, I mean, MNRE has come out and SECI have come out with an auction which is going to complement renewable energy with thermal, right? With with coal thermal. And you know, in our discussions with the ministry, they have mentioned that if this option is successful, they'll come out with more such auctions. They'll come out with auctions which will complement solar and wind with hydro. It could complement solar and wind with gas. So, you know, they could be new pump storage projects being built, which will be more at this point in time more reasonably priced than battery storage. So India needs to look for these innovative solutions. Using gas and thermal is in my opinion a brilliant idea, because so much investment, so much public investment has gone into these stranded assets that it'll be criminal if they are allowed to wither away. It is almost a responsibility of the country to use those assets that are standing. You know, whatever the Western world might say about using coal and gas, you know, we have to, as a nation, look at what makes sense for us. And throwing away public money certainly doesn't feature in that list of things for India to do. So I think it's a great initiative, and I hope we get competitive bids. And I hope we can bring in dispatchable renewable power through these mechanisms even before storage becomes mainstream.
Right. Thank you. So I will not take much time. So I just ask quickly one more question I have. That as we know that India is having the biggest target in the solar industry. So many of the solar projects so far has been installed in the solar parks, as we have seen. But in the last few years, we have seen that ISTS tenders have been out, and incomparably to the solar park tenders. Solar park tenders has gone slower. So Azure Power, being one of the largest IPPs in many big projects, so what is your opinion on which mode it is better? I mean, solar parks or ISTS, which mode it would be better?
But these are not, mutually exclusive, right? I mean, at the end of the day, we can have ISTS solar projects also, and we can have, solar projects which are non-ISTS. So they are not mutually exclusive. As far as ISTS is concerned, the current trend over the last 2 or 3 years has been ISTS, and that has been made possible because of the ISTS waiver. Once the waiver goes away, you will see between 80 paisa to 1 rupee and up to 2 rupees being added to the tariffs, which might become untenable for the states. So we might see a return to the state bids, which where the projects will be put up within the state. Of course, some states will still find it difficult to build large solar projects because of paucity of land and paucity of insulation. And they'll probably still have no option but to do ISTS projects, albeit at higher prices. But I think once the ISTS waiver goes away, we will see a decline in the ISTS tenders because of the cost of ISTS. But it is a healthy thing because subsidies distort the market, right? I mean, the subsidies are good to get the industry to stand on its feet. But, there has to be a time when subsidies are removed from the sector to make it, to fully understand what exactly is the cost of that power to the nation. By not charging an ISTS charge, we are distorting the cost and, we are making it look the balance is not correct, right? So we should not have these subsidies given the size of our business, and we still have 2.5 years, almost 3 years for the ISTS waiver to be removed. And in 3 years' time, our industry will be even bigger. We'll be 60,000-70,000 megawatts of solar power installed, and including wind, it'll be like 130,000-140,000 megawatts of power installed. It'll be a very large industry, which perhaps does not need this crutch of ISTS waiver for it to succeed. This will, like I said, move some of the projects to the state. We can still continue to have SECI or NTPC or NHPC as intermediaries, as they used to be in the past, but more projects will probably shift to state grids once the ISTS waiver goes away.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your opinion, sir. Over to you, Anandji.
Thank you, Mr. Pradeep. Thank you, Mr. Ranjit. I think it was extremely interesting and insightful, and we learned a lot of new perspectives and dimensions about the common issues that the industry has been facing. I wish you all the good luck in your professional and all the very best for Azure Power in times to come, sir. I'm definitely sure that Azure will definitely do much more than it has dreamed of. I wish you a very good evening and a very good weekend, sir, and I really hope that you enjoyed talking to us as much as we did.
Thank you. Thanks, Anand, and thanks to all the participants. Thanks to Prateek for being patient listeners, and thank you all for giving me this opportunity to talk about Azure.
Thank you.
It is definitely a big privilege and big honor for all of us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.